Has anybody never attended a copyright training? Oh, okay, a few people, okay. Well, I'm only gonna cover part of what I do in my basic orientation today. I'm not gonna do the whole orientation, because basically what I wanted to share with you today are the copyright updates and what's new since, you know, from the last 4 years, from 4 years ago. So, I originally wrote the copyright manual in 2015, 4 years ago, and since then the copyright scene has changed. So this year, I went through and totally updated it, and I want to introduce you to Lucy Clayton. She works in my same division in the TI department, and she does a lot of the multimedia copyright things that are on things for the web. So we collaborated on this book. And we updated it. She sent me a ton of suggestions a while ago, and I incorporated those, so we have a fully updated manual for 2019. Now, the nice thing about this manual, in case you haven't ever seen it, and it is available in a lot of formats, I'll go over that in a minute, but the nice thing about this, it's not just general copyright knowledge. It's not just a lot of boring stuff to read, taken from government publications and other things. This is basically the basic training I give, plus the advanced training I give specifically to teachers and curriculum developers here at DLI. It's how we personally apply copyright in the classroom when we're developing materials and when we're writing our own courses. It's not for any other organization. It's not for anybody except our teachers. So it's written in the same language that I give my trainings in. So it should be very readable and very useful if you have any question at all about the materials you're using, what's the difference between fair use and creating reusable teaching materials, which are two completely different activities. One is you can do anything you want in the classroom, and the other one is you have to have permission to create materials that you're going to use more than one time. Or you have to use materials that are free to use for everybody. So everything is answered in here in a way that you can read it and understand it and immediately apply it to your job. Okay, so...
Is that available to us?
Yes, it is. I'm going to go into that right now. Okay, from the beginning. I don't know if there's a clicker or anything. So, today we're going to go over what's new in the copyright manual and in the copyright world. So, this manual is available online. In fact, I think the assistant commandant actually emailed it to every single person at DLI. If you can't find that email, you could write to me or to Lucy at copyright@dlifoc.edu. Very easy to remember, copyright@dlifoc.edu. We're the two people that get those emails. And so one or the other of us will answer you. And we can send you the PDF that I just showed you. That PDF has links in it. So when you click on the table of contents, it takes you right there. When you click on an appendix to find out more about something, it takes you right there. So it's really easy to use. It should be in all the school servers, and they printed 400 copies and distributed it to all the UGE schools. So somewhere in your school, you've got copies of this, if you want to look at the hard copy. Or you can just download the PDF and print out any sections you need or the whole book. So it's quite freely available. And if you can't find it anywhere else, just write me and I'll send it to you. Okay, so what's new about the permission list? And I'm so glad Lisa's here today because she's been working really hard on updating the permission lists. And especially for the countries whose copyright situations have recently changed, like Afghanistan. So if you need to know what kind of materials to use, the quickest, most efficient way is to request at that email, copyright@dlifoc.edu, just simply request your language list, whether it's Arabic or French or, you know, Pashto, whatever, and Lucy will get your email and she'll print out, she'll send you the latest, most up-to-date list in your language. And we have about 40 languages, so it's very easy to get your list of permitted sites. All you have to do is remember this one email address, okay? Now, what's new in the world of copyright is Afghanistan signed the World Treaty Organization in July 2016 and the Berne Convention in June of 2018. So these are copyright agreements between countries. Prior to this, Afghanistan had not been a signatory on any copyright agreement, which meant that they could grab materials from anywhere in the world and use them for whatever they wanted, and we could grab their materials and use them for whatever we wanted. Because there was no agreement, it was just, you know, piracy was okay. And even, you know, nobody could sue you because they hadn't signed an agreement. So our course developers and our teachers in the Afghan program, language programs, were able to just go to the websites that originated in Afghanistan and freely use any materials they wanted without permission. And they've been enjoying this for years and years and years, and all of a sudden, bang, it's changed. Now they have to go back and look at their curriculum. Anything before, any materials that they grabbed before 29th of July 2016, they can keep in their books. Anything from the 29th in 2016, they have to write and ask permission or take it out of their textbook. And it's the same for the whatever the teachers have developed and put up on the server. If it's predated to that date, it's fine to keep using it and reusing it and reusing it. From that date forward, they have to either have permission or take it down or use a workaround. And I'm going to explain the workaround as another part. So this is a huge change for Pashto and any other languages associated with the Afghan program. And I don't have this on the slide, but something similar is happening to the Persian Farsi. They still haven't signed any copyright agreements, so we should be able to take any materials we want that are published in Iran and use them for our curriculum. But the situation has drastically changed recently. They're writing a new Persian Farsi course, and the head of that course is a journalist, and he's very knowledgeable about copyright matters in Iran. And so what they're doing in Iran and also in South Sudan is, as soon as a news organization comes out with a broadcast, a newspaper, or anything, they have offices outside of Iran. And they have now syndicated pretty much all of their news. So syndication is a way that they've found around this. So as soon, like when something is published in Iran, they have 30 days to get it published outside of Iran. Otherwise it's in the public domain. I mean, it's not public domain, but we can use it. So within that 30-day limit, if they do manage to get all of their news articles and all of their TV shows and everything published outside of Iran, then they're fully copyrighted and we can't grab them anymore. So syndication is what they're using. They syndicate everything now. It all comes out at the same time. All their news is published in other countries. And so that means that if we go and grab it, we can get sued because the news agency that's broadcasting it, it's copyrighted through them. It has their copyright on it. So in the Persian Farsi school, they're experiencing the same exact thing. Except in Afghanistan, you can write and get permissions, but in Iran, you can't. So they're having to do some pretty complicated tap dances around this problem, because they can no longer just freely use whatever they want. Okay. So these are the countries that have not signed agreements: Iran, Iraq, and South Sudan. So if you find anything published in those three countries, you don't need to get written permission. If the author lives in the country and the material is created in those countries and it was published only in these countries on their websites and not outside. South Sudan, they're doing a similar thing. All the artists and craftsmen who are creating art or writing books, they're running over to other countries nearby and getting them copyrighted outside of South Sudan so that their works are protected. So people are getting a little more sophisticated. Now, I wanted to just talk briefly about the Creative Commons. There's a new update about the Creative Commons that you need to know about. So just briefly, I'm not going to teach you about the licenses. These are the six licenses called Creative Commons. Sites like Wikipedia and Flickr and YouTube, they all have Creative Commons sections where you can go and use those materials, because these yellow licenses in the middle give us permission to use the materials under those specific terms. And for our teachers in the UGE school and for our curriculum developers, as long as they follow the terms, they can use pretty much anything they want that has a Creative Commons license in their reusable teaching materials. Now, I'm not talking about standing up in front of your class and just showing a one-time news article. I'm talking about downloading that news article, putting it in a fixed form, writing questions, creating a class, and using it over and over and sharing it with other teams. That's what I'm talking about. Reusable. Okay? So if it has Creative Commons license, basically you can reuse it. Now, something that's different though is we used to have it creativecommons.org. Oh, that should be an S there. But anyway, search.creativecommons.org, and you would get this page. But what's new is if you search creativecommons.org, you're going to get this new page, and it's very, very unhelpful page. You don't want it, because when you click to find out where the sources are, it's just a bunch of old museums and stuff. It doesn't really help us with the kinds of foreign language materials we need. So then you look here, are you looking for the old Creative Commons search portal? You click there, and then you'll get, how do I go back? There we go. And then you'll come to this one. So the new title to type in is oldsearch.creativecommons.org to get to this page. And when you're on this page, you can type here in any language, right? You can use any language keyboard to type in, and you'll get different results based on whether you type in English or Arabic or whatever. So if you're looking for Arabic materials, you want to type in Arabic, right? You type your keyword. And another thing that's new is I used to say to uncheck one box, but now I want you to uncheck both boxes to get the widest search. And from here, you can search on Google Images, Wikimedia, YouTube. This is the big important one. You can find Creative Commons YouTube videos in your language that you can download and use freely for anything you want. Flickr, Pixabay, which is the public domain site for images. So what's new, if you're familiar with Creative Commons, is you have to type in this new URL, oldsearch.creativecommons.org, to get the window that we use to find our materials. So that's what's new.
Is there an internet here?
Hmm?
Is there an internet here connection?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
No?
They should be.
Yeah, I have it.
So I can get to the site.
Yeah, I can get to the site for you. Let me just see if it's ready to go.
Unless there's no internet.
Yeah, no, we've got it. Okay, so HTTPS. oldsearch.creativecommons.org. There we go. Okay, so you're going to untick these two boxes, and then you're going to type in whatever your keywords are, like Chinese New Year food.
So, do Did you put the S at the end or?
Oh, wait, let me go back here.
HTTPS.
What S? Oh, I put, yeah, HTTPS. That's wrong on the site. Let's say we're gonna click YouTube. Okay, so here we go. Now, if I had typed that in Chinese, I would have videos in Chinese language. You see? So all of these, let's just click this one.
The second I finish the dry lotus.
Okay, and then we want to look at show more. And we're looking for the, here we go. License, Creative Commons Attribution License. Reuse is allowed. That's what you look for. Okay? And then you go show less. And then if you want to use this video, you click the share button. And you can either, they should have a, well.
I should go down, it's written below.
Yeah, there you go. You can either copy this link and paste the link, or you can click embed. If they have this embed code on, you're allowed to copy this embed code. Okay, so we're going to copy it, right? And then you can embed it on a website. You can embed this video on a website like Sakai. If you're doing UCAT classes, the UCAT people will not allow you to embed videos. They're afraid of viruses. But you can embed it on a Sakai class site. If you're creating your classes on Sakai or your own web channel or whatever you're doing, you can embed it and then you can use it freely. Okay? Because it has a Creative Commons license. So that's how to use Creative Commons. Let's see what else. The other thing about the Creative Commons is okay, if you, let's say we clicked this video.
The second I finish the dry lotus cookie.
And you see all these other videos off to the side? These are not necessarily Creative Commons. They could be fully, these videos here could be fully copyrighted. So don't ever, if you're looking for Creative Commons, don't ever click there. Go back to this original list that the filter gave you and keep looking in this list for the video you want. Okay? And then if again on this page, you don't always have to choose YouTube, you could click a different one. You could click Flickr, for example. And here it filters all the Flickr photos, and all of these photos should be Creative Commons. So you can use any one of them you want. So we can click on one, let's see, and then we'll check the, you see here, right here, the little man that says some rights reserved, that's the Creative Commons symbol. So you can download and use this image for anything you want, and you can download it in any of these sizes. And you can use it in your reusable teaching materials, no problem. The main thing is you have to understand the licenses. Like this one right here means that you can even change the photo. You can crop it and change it, do whatever you want with it. But if it has a share alike symbol, which is a circular arrow, then you can't make any changes. So, I mean, you have to understand the terms, and we're not going to teach that today. Okay, so that's the Creative Commons site. And that's what's new, like how to find this green and yellow page. That's the important thing. And this Creative Commons site is going to be your new best friend. It has videos, it has news articles, it has images. You can search it and search it in any language, and there's thousands of new things going into Creative Commons every day, maybe tens of thousands all over the world. So it's an enormous resource and very easy to use. Okay. So, now, we're talking about these countries that we can no longer just freely grab their stuff and use it. So, a lot of people are developing in a new way. The old way of developing a curriculum, let's say, would be to create a print copy. But now different schools have gone to UCAT or Sakai, and they have a lot more online. And when you have materials online, even if it's your core curriculum, it makes it easy to make changes. Because if you're not allowed to get permission, let's say Iran, or maybe there's some Arabic channels you want, like Al Jazeera, we've never been able to get permission yet from them. Although we can keep trying, there's no harm in trying. But let's say you don't have permission, but you really want to use something, you want to use a video or whatever, you can do it by using links and keywords. It's not illegal to create a reusable class or even a curriculum and put links in it. Links are illegal. Anybody can click the link and it's called personal use. You're not downloading the materials and putting it in a fixed form and then republishing it on the web. Everything you put on the web, you are legally responsible for as a publisher. I don't know if people know that. So if you're stealing things that are copyrighted and even putting them up on your own personal site, or you're downloading, you know, a soap opera and putting it on your YouTube channel, you're committing a federal crime. It's a copyright violation. It's a very big crime. It's tried in federal courts, and the expenses of if you're found guilty are extremely high. So, and DLI doesn't want to be sued again successfully as they have in the past. They don't want to keep paying out money. So the answer for these countries like Iran and Afghanistan, if they cannot get permission, or even certain Arabic ones, is to create activities where you give the students several different ways to go and find the material for themselves. Personal use is not illegal. Anybody can click the link. You know, six students and whoever's teaching the class, they can all go in and click the link, and it's perfectly legal because they're not downloading and storing them and using them in a fixed form. Okay? The problem with links is that links can change. They can disappear. They can change location. And that's why in our printed textbooks, like this is basically my textbook to teach copyright. So I've got tons and tons and tons of links in it. And when I went to update it, for example, there were 30 or 40 links that were dead from 4 years ago. So I had to go and search for, and because it's in a printed form, it's really hard to change it, right? So I had to go and I had to look up every one of these articles by doing a search for the title of the article and find out the new place it was located and replace the old link with a new link. And sometimes I couldn't find the article anywhere, so I had to eliminate it from the book in order to update this book. It's the same with our language courses. If they're mainly in a printed copy, then you have to understand that this book has to be good for 5 to 10 years going forward. And if you've based all of your coursework on links, a whole bunch of them are going to stop working and they're not going to be able to use the core curriculum. So we don't want that to happen. So if you're writing a textbook, I usually recommend only use links in optional materials that are not necessary. So what are these courses, like the Persian Farsi course, going to do if none of the materials are available and they cannot write for permission because it's not a friendly country and their families are there and there's all kinds of reasons why we can't write for permission? So I would recommend in this case that they develop their course either on UCAT or Sakai, because then they can use links everywhere for the materials they want. And if they go to class one day and the link isn't working, they could set up, this is what I recommended, that they set up a little office with one or two people who are responsible for updating links. As soon as the teacher finds the link doesn't work, they contact them. That person who's responsible will search for that article and update the link to the new location. Like news articles, for instance, could get archived somewhere on a different link. So they could update those right away, you know. Or if it doesn't exist anymore, they can alert the copyright team that writes the materials and say, this entire activity needs to be replaced because it's no longer working. right? This video is no longer available. So, I developed two little mini classes, let's say, to show people how to use links and keywords. And this is like for a video link. It could be a news article, it could be a movie, it could be a soap opera. So all of these things are copyrighted, not legal for us to download, but we can go ahead and put the link in, right? So I wrote this little class. It's this slide and the next slide. It's a reusable class that can be used over and over and over. It can be shared. It doesn't matter. There's nothing in here that's illegal. So what I do is I put three different instructions how to find the material. So one is click the link. If the link's working, fine, then go ahead and do the activity. If the link's not working, then they can use keywords, like go to YouTube, type in these keywords, and watch the 10-minute clip. A lot of times, if a video has been taken down off YouTube, 20 other people have also reposted it, so you can still find it, right? But if you can't find it at all, then we tell the students, go use any search engine you want, find this film, and watch a 10-minute portion starting at 30 minutes and 10 seconds. So students will figure out how to access the movie illegally, which is okay, because it's a personal search, and then they're not gonna download it, they're not gonna rip it or anything, they're just gonna watch that 10-minute clip, and then they can do the activities, okay? If it's unavailable in every possible way out of these three ways, then that's when this activity has to be completely replaced with something else. So the second page of this is questions. Okay. So that's one class. Now the next one is a reading activity. And this one's really interesting. So it says news text using one source or a variety of sources. Now this is something that could be put in a permanent curriculum. So you give the students the same instructions. Follow the link, and then if they click on this link, they can read the article and do the activities. That's fine. Everybody's working on the same news article, answering the questions. But if the link is no longer there, then I say go to the website where I found the article, and I'll explain over three later, and type in Occupy Central Movement in Hong Kong and do the activities. So they go to the website and they type in the keywords and they're going to find some article. They may each come up with a different article. And so in number three it says find any news article or news items specifically on the topic of Occupy the Central Movement in Hong Kong. Okay, so this was a movement that went on for years. Central is downtown Hong Kong. Students were protesting against the Chinese government. This is after China took over Hong Kong for various rights and things that they felt the Chinese government wasn't keeping their word on. And so let's say that that you have six students in your class and each one of them finds a different article to work with. So what you want to do, the key to making this work, even for a permanent curriculum, is to ask questions that are generic enough that they can be used with any article, but specific enough to be on that topic. So this is an example. So let's say that I have six students and they're all sitting there and reading a different article about the Occupy movement. So first of all, each of them can fill in this chart. They can fill in the EEI chart about the article they read. And then what is mentioned about the Chinese government's response? Well, I personally know that of the thousands of articles written about Occupy Hong Kong movement, the reporter always has a sentence about, you know, the Chinese government responded by such and such, or the Hong Kong government, which is the Chinese government, responded to the students' protest by doing such and such, or issuing some proclamation, or they did not respond. You see what I mean? So there's always a way to answer that question, depending on the article. And then a higher level, what changes do you think will take place? So now you're asking for an opinion and a future projection. And class discussion, what part of your article did you find most interesting and why? So all of these questions can be answered no matter which article the student is working with. And in a sense, it broadens the discussion, and every student is contributing new information, which kind of creates almost an automatic info gap, where they get a much broader idea about the Occupy Central movement. Okay? Because sometimes there could be a violent response, and sometimes it could be absolutely peaceful, but then it gives them a broader idea. So I think this is a good method for courses where they simply cannot get permissions. Or if you encounter something you really want to use, but you've tried and can't get permission. And I think they're going to have to use this more and more because of the situation in Iran, Afghanistan. Okay, then we've got our on again, off again Skola. So this is something new. Skola is now off again. I just wanted to bring that up. It's something new. It was on for years and years, then they turned it off for a year or two, then they turned it back on for a year and paid for it, and now it's off again. So the schools were supposed to have created archives for all the years that we did have permission. So if there's a specific topic that, we have a lot of topics that don't need to be current in 2019, you know what I mean? Like parts of the body and medical, you know, you can use anything from any year because, you know, the parts of our bodies don't change. So they're always the same vocabulary, right? So we have a number of topics throughout the entire course that are not dated. So if you're creating materials, it doesn't really matter how old they are if it has the right vocabulary. So just so you know, Skola is off again. You can't use any current broadcast, but you can use everything in our archive. The other thing that was new in 2018, some of our curriculum developers went to the lawyers because they said our teachers and our curriculum teams simply don't have enough videos to use for teaching, speaking, and audio and things like that. So the lawyers went through YouTube terms of service. And what they discovered, remember I showed you how we came to that YouTube video and we clicked on the share button and then we saw the link and then we saw the embed code. So what the lawyers discovered was when anybody uploads a video, even if it's a fully copyrighted video, if they don't turn off those options, then they're agreeing that people can download them. Now, as far as republishing them, that's where you could get into trouble. But you can download them, and if they didn't turn off the embed code, you can embed them on your teaching website. Okay? So, I don't think I would go as far as embedding it in a full course curriculum, because that one will get published by the Joint Language University, and it's just out of our control. It's also made available for free on the DLI website. It could go totally out of control and put those videos into the public domain by mistake, for which we could get sued. But if you're doing teaching in the classroom and you have your little teaching site on Sakai or whatever, you can actually download any video you want, copyrighted or not, and use it for your teaching, because they didn't turn off the embed code. So it's a help to teach classroom teachers. I would say the best use for that is to help classroom teachers be able to use more YouTube videos. And they only looked into YouTube. They didn't look into Vimeo or anything else. So you stick to YouTube. So you can download it, you can link it, and you can embed it. That's what the lawyers said. And they had a couple of caveats. If you don't see the embed code, that means that they purposely turned it off, which means you cannot rip it off illegally any other way. You can't fiddle with the functions. You can't upload a special you know, programmed to pirate it, it's not available, okay? You should put up a little disclaimer stating that you're not endorsing any ads and that you only use legitimate YouTube videos. What that means is, let's say that you have a favorite news agency and then you've discovered that there's somebody out there on the web, some private person, and maybe they have a political agenda. So all the videos that they can find on that topic, they have this YouTube channel that they've created, their own personal YouTube channel, and they're downloading copyrighted videos and putting them there, and you said, well, okay, well, over there the news agency did it, but here, you know, Mr. Abdul Muhammad has put all these videos in the Creative Commons, so now I can use them. Well, he's illegally uploaded them and illegally changed their copyright notification to something where you think you can use it, but it's still illegal. So you're still legally responsible, because ignorance of the law is no excuse in a law case. You should know if you're doing that activity. So you don't want to download the news article from Abdul Muhammad's private website where he assigned it a Creative Commons video. You want to go to the actual news site where the video is legally posted. And if it's copyrighted, but it still has the link and the embed code, you can grab the link or you can grab the embed code and embed it. I just wouldn't do it for a DLI official course, but for teachers. The lawyers said it's fine. Okay. And lastly, just this is nothing new, it's just a reminder. No matter what materials you use from the web, you need to give credit and you need to document it. So to give credit, you want to mention the source and the creator, like Wikipedia Steve Evans, he took a photo of the Mazar-e Sharif building mosque, whatever it is. And then you want to copy and save the URL. That's called documenting the source. Where did you get it from? So these things that we always, always, always do, whether you're creating class materials, whether you're creating a course, doesn't matter. Okay, so just a reminder, give credit and document where you got it. And if you have any questions, if you get any permissions, send in all the new permissions you acquire, and then request an up-to-date list of permitted sites. Lucy is the one who keeps the database up-to-date. She creates these reports. So if you write to this copyright at dlifoc.edu and you want to get a list of new permissions, or you have a new permission that you want to add that you just got, Lucy will take care of all that for you. And then for me, if you want to ask questions about copyrights or request training for yourself or your school, then I will answer your email. Yes?
Is the handout in the manual?
The handout is, this is the handout right here. Let me open it up for you.
The one that you handed me.
Yeah, it's called the Copyright Quick Tips. So I have updated this. This used to be called the Cheat Sheet.
Yeah.
Now it's called Quick Tips. And I've updated it to go along with the new 2019 manual, because things like page numbers and appendix numbers have changed.
So it's not in the old, it was sent by the system coming up, right?
Yes, this was also sent. I updated it for him and he sends it out to everybody. And this is just a two-page summary of what's in the book and where to find things. So unless there's any questions,
is that in the library by any chance, the manual?
It should be. Yes. It should be, yes. And if it's not, tell them they need to get some copies of it.
Okay.
Okay, let me show you that again.
Oh, I'm fine. Good to see you.
No, no, no.